Manchester University Press presents this unabridged recording of Ecocide, Kill the Corporation Before It Kills Us, by David Whyte. Read by Steph Bauer. Preface. From COVID-capitalism to survival of the species. There is an almost mythical story of an alternative to capitalist production, developed by workers in the British arms industry in the 1970s and 1980s, that is sometimes hazily recalled by older political activists. It is a story that should be dusted down and its lessons relearned as a guide to our times. The Combine Plan, developed by a large number of unionised engineering workers, employed by the arms corporation Lucas Aerospace, is one that seems more and more incredible as the years go by. Those workers, fed up with their skills being used to produce weapons, developed prototypes of a number of socially useful technologies. Many of their inventions were groundbreaking and were not fully developed for many years. Wind turbines, electric vehicles, and a type of energy-efficient heat pump that is now widely used. The list goes on and on. Those workers were responding innovatively to the collapse of the British manufacturing industry and sought to harness the country's capacity for making the things that were really needed, not merely the things that could easily sell. Tragically, despite the detailed plans and business cases and the revolutionary inventions that came together years ahead of their time, the Lucas Plan failed to gain the support of government or private investors. Some of the industries that today bear the most blame for the climate crisis, including auto manufacture, air transport, and the arms industry, are all likely to suffer major long-term losses as a result of the COVID-19 crisis. They could do with a Lucas Plan. On the manufacturing side, the UK company Rolls-Royce is projected to lose 8,000 jobs, and all of the major airlines are projecting thousands upon thousands of job losses. The human tragedy of the virus will be immeasurably compounded by the economic fallout. Yet, our commitment to a booming, carbon-based air transport sector seems absurd at the moment, as does the scale of public investment in arms. And yet, there are signs that repurposing both transport and arms companies in this day and age might not be possible, but essential. At the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic in the UK, British military giant BAE Systems very quickly started producing essential medical supplies, including face masks and ventilation units. Although the examples of an immediate switch in production are relatively small, such cases do show the potential we have to transform our economy. However, none of the economic measures introduced by advanced capitalist states in response to COVID-19 have seriously sought to make our economy more sustainable. Indeed, governments around the world, rather than taking a Lucas-style approach, have only one solution: protect the system as it is. Initial business support packages in Europe were valued at around 15% of GDP in countries like Spain, Germany, France, and the UK. The final value, which we will all pay for in the long run, will certainly be much more. In the US, just 3 months into the crisis, the bailout was valued at around 3 times the total for the government-backed funds made available following the 2008 economic crash. They are called business support packages because that is exactly what they are: wage subsidies. Most of those payments went to corporate payroll departments rather than directly to workers. Large government-backed loans and one-off payments to keep transport and infrastructure corporations afloat. Another tranche went to the self-employed and small businesses, largely to maintain a labour market based on the casualised and cheap labour that our major corporations thrive on. An iron rule of corporate capitalism has been revealed by this crisis again, perhaps more clearly than before. The profit-making corporations at the heart of the system can only survive economic shocks if they're kept on life support by us. The scale of this life support effort has revealed to us how possible and indeed necessary a major economic transformation might be. Yet, at this undeniably decisive point for the future of the planet, no one is asking how we use the immense resources being thrown at COVID-19 to precipitate a social transformation that does not involve reproducing the means of our own self-destruction. This is precisely the question asked and answered in full by the Lucas Aerospace workers. With 40 years of hindsight now, more than ever before, we need to ask the most fundamental questions about how we can survive as a species. There is, at the same time, a sinister, hidden aspect of this bailout. In many countries around the world, there has been a silent crusade against the safety and environmental standards that corporations are expected to meet. European car manufacturers have been demanding subsidies to ensure survival, and in the very same breath, have been lobbying hard for CO2 emission standards to be lowered. In Canada, oil and gas companies have been pushing to lift environmental regulations, and the Keystone XL pipeline to facilitate the extraction of high-carbon oil from tar sands was approved with a $5 billion subsidy. In the US, the government has used the crisis to speed up the repeal of environmental laws and the sale of land to oil and gas mining and timber corporations. The US Environmental Protection Agency has suspended enforcement of environmental laws. The Chinese government gifted its coal industry with an unprecedented mass issue of new mining permits. Many US states lifted rules on single-use plastics. In England, the ban on plastic straws was postponed, and plastic manufacturers in Europe are fighting hard to shelve the ban on plastic forks. The list goes on and on. Most galling for some has been that many of the stimulus packages prioritised some of the worst environmental offenders. The Bank of England's qualitative easing programme included BP and Rio Tinto, of whom we will hear more later in the book. Why, when those sectors are clearly failing and are unable to withstand the shock, is our government's automatic reflex to protect investors at our expense? Why is the government's auto-reflex not to protect our environmental standards, but to support the fossil fuel industry and weaken existing regulation and controls that could help us reverse climate change and the ecological crisis? Crispin Odie, who made an estimated £115 million from the crisis by betting on market failure in March 2020, has also invested heavily in projects that destroy the environment. In February, Odie increased his stake in Brazilian firm SLC Agricola, a corporation that has been revealed to have a stake in deforestation. The system of investment that determines what is valued and who makes money from crises is cyclical. Social disasters reap profits, which are then ploughed into environmental disasters, producing more social disasters, and on it goes. A sick game that we can only stand back and watch. It is difficult to see how this predatory cycle of investment can be broken. Odie is unusual in the sense that most investors are able to remain completely anonymous. Indeed, if you want to remain removed and distant from the source of your wealth, you can. This is the real scandal of social distancing that we need to talk about in light of COVID-19. Since, as this book will show, this feature of capitalist systems has a more pernicious and central role in destroying our planet than we ever acknowledge. The COVID-19 crisis has put into sharper focus the stark choice we face for the future of the planet. We can choose to depart from the crisis by developing a sustainable economy and sustainable jobs, a green industrial revolution. Or we can simply allow the biggest corporations to win again and strip away any environmental regulations that stand meekly in their way. There are obvious alternatives to the way our failed systems are organised. We have a whole range of other models, tried and successfully tested in different countries, normally after things have failed in the past. From Argentina to the Basque Country and Catalonia, we could recite an ABC of alternatives to capitalist production that have been created by people just to survive the economic shocks of the 21st century. We know from real, lived human experience in the aftermath of economic crises that protecting corporations and their investors is not the only way to organise an economy. The problem is that they would mean removing the right of the ultimate beneficiaries of the corporation, investors, to profit in perpetuity. It would also mean removing the rights and privileges of their most senior managers and directors. In other words, dealing with the corporation means precipitating a fundamental shift in the balance of social classes. It means overturning the social position of elites. COVID-19 is one of many global tragedies we will witness in our lifetime. Yet, it is because of its global nature that we've no choice but to recognise the nuts and bolts of how pandemics like this germinate. There is clear evidence that new strains of viruses like COVID-19 are only able to move between species in large-scale factory meat farms. It is no coincidence that our most recent outbreaks were swine flu, H1N1, and bird flu, H5N1. Those are the most intensely farmed animals and that are kept in environments that are of a scale that allow viruses to mutate from animals to humans. What are those industries characterized by? The domination of large corporations. Huge global pork producers like Smithfield and poultry producers like Tyson and Doo have led a revolution in meat production that is based upon growing the scale and intensity of farms. This is not to say that those corporations are responsible for COVID-19 or any other virus. Rather, it is a particular model of capitalism that is at fault. And this model creates the conditions that simultaneously allow corporations to dominate and viruses to spread. At one level, this is an unfortunate coincidence. But given that the domination of the sector by large corporations facilitates and encourages viral conditions, the reality of the situation is that we need to break this model of corporate capitalism if we are to have any chance of controlling future outbreaks. If we cannot contemplate such a basic human need as food production outside the structure of corporate capitalism after what we have just been through, then we are destined to face the ultimate human existential threat. Indeed, as this book will argue, if we don't imagine food production, energy, transport, and indeed all extractive and manufacturing industries outside the structure of corporate capitalism, then we reduce our chances of humans surviving as a species catastrophically. Long after the COVID-19 crisis has passed, future generations will look at this period as a moment that everything might have changed direction, a moment that woke us up to the fact that we could not live side by side with corporations. They will question why we did not break the back of a corporate structure that is killing us. Most of all, they will question why we did not kill the corporation when we had the chance. David Whyte, May 2020. Introduction. Corporate Ecocide. The world's first corporation was a Swedish mining company called Stora Kopparberg. The founding certificate of the company, dated 1288, is the earliest documented evidence of a profit-making corporation. It was established by German merchants as a means of investing in a copper mine in the town of Fallen, and it was a roaring success. In the 17th century, two-thirds of European copper production took place in Fallen, and the mine remained an important site for copper production until it closed in the 1990s. The site of the Fallen mine is now on the UNESCO World Heritage List. The idea that the world's first corporation was born in Sweden has been a matter of national pride over the years. Stora Kopparberg's founding documents were part of the Swedish exhibition at the 1964 World Fair in New York and are now held in the National Archives in Stockholm. Remarkably, the corporation still exists today. In its present-day guise, Stora Kopparberg, now known as Stora Enso, is the second largest paper producer in the world and is based in Helsinki. The mine has left an enduring mark on its environment. Scientific studies of the surrounding areas reveal that both land and watercourses have been permanently damaged. One study by Swedish researchers concluded that the lakes are acidified and unlikely to recover, and that extremely high metal concentrations in the soil indicate very long-lasting and perhaps irreversible environmental damage. As we shall see in subsequent chapters, in recent years, Stora Enso has also been accused of causing significant damage to biodiversity in forests across the world. And so the legacy continues. Yet at no point in its long history has Stora Kopparberg had to face questions about its environmental record, let alone pay the costs of a clean-up or compensation for any damage it has caused. Indeed, in its modern incarnation, Stora Enso seems to have managed to escape any association with the Fallen mine or its legacy. As this book will show, this is the point of the corporation. It enables investors to walk away from the damage caused by their activities without ever having to face the consequences. The Stora story will unfold in more detail throughout this book. As we shall discover, the story of the world's first profit-making corporation symbolizes the fundamental problem that this book seeks to confront. No matter how much destruction corporations cause to us and our environment, they are designed to survive and thrive in perpetuity. This book is about ecocide, the deliberate destruction of our natural environment. Ecocide as a term captures the entirety of the threats to the sustainability of the planet. Climate change, the ravaging of ecosystems, the eradication of species, and the pollution of air, land, and water. The book will argue that it is impossible to avert ecocide as long as corporations remain in control of the industrial processes that are wrecking our world. Capitalism, Ecocide, and the Corporation. As this book progresses, we will discover exactly why the contemporary form of the profit-making corporation is probably as close as we could get to a model organization that is capable of destroying the world. If this sounds like a description of Spectre, the evil organization from the Bond films, or Marvel's AIM, then in many ways the truth is more terrifying than fiction. The book will show how the profit-making corporation, the form of organization that dominates contemporary capitalism, evolved into the deadliest human invention, an invention that has accelerated the capacity for the destruction of the planet in ways its creators could never have imagined. This is a critique of capitalism at the core of the movement against climate change, led by groups like Climate Camp, Extinction Rebellion, and the school students' movement, Fridays for Future. On the global climate strike on the 20th of September 2019, some of the most used slogans directed attention at capitalism. System change, not climate change. Capitalism kills our future. And El capitalismo mata el planeta. This growing movement is putting the way that the capitalist system organises our economy and the way that it makes and consumes things to the forefront of the struggle against climate change. A nascent movement against climate change within the trade union movement is also driven by a critique of capitalism. This movement is absolutely right in its critique. Understanding how capitalism works is a crucial starting point for understanding the driving forces behind the eco-crisis. Capitalism as a system is based on perpetual growth and the continual reproduction of private wealth. And for reasons explored in the book, in the capitalist system, the protection of the environment is always subordinated to the accumulation of profit for a privileged elite. The relationship between capitalism and ecocide becomes clear when we analyse the logics and practices of capital. Indeed, the book will show that the corporation, the mechanism that capital uses to reproduce itself, was designed in a way that virtually guarantees ecocide. Understanding the capitalist corporation and then doing something about it must therefore be at the centre of the struggle to control climate change and the ecological crisis. Ecocide is a term that is increasingly being used in the renewed protest movement against climate change. Indeed, the proposal to make ecocide a crime has become one of the demands of Extinction Rebellion. It has become a topic of interest for academic lawyers and criminologists and has influenced criminal law in a small number of states. The profit-making corporation was at the heart of the political debates that gave birth to the concept of ecocide almost half a century ago. In 1972, Olaf Palme, the Prime Minister of Sweden, used the concept to describe the use of napalm and the defoliant Agent Orange during the Vietnam War. Chemical warfare in Vietnam was being used to slaughter people in enemy territory, destroy their villages and wipe out forests and crops. Palme, along with other world leaders, including Indian Prime Minister Indira Gandhi, called for ecocide to be an international crime. And subsequently, international lawyer Richard Falk published a draft ecocide convention directly in response to those calls. Though it was never adopted, the convention provided the legal basis for outlawing the use of chemical substances to clear people from the land in wartime or peacetime. It estimated that 4.8 million people were directly sprayed with Agent Orange, and around 400,000 people died immediately. The Vietnamese Red Cross estimates that a further 1 million people were disabled or suffered severe health problems, and Vietnamese babies are still being born today with congenital disorders caused by the persistence of the chemical in the biosphere. The chemical was sprayed on almost a fifth of the landmass of Vietnam, and tree stocks and animal life are still severely depleted in those areas and unlikely to recover. 9 different private chemical companies, led by Monsanto, had been given the job of developing and manufacturing Agent Orange for the US military. There have been a number of legal actions taken against those companies, specifically Dow, Monsanto, and Diamond Shamrock. Those companies have, like the US military, continued to deny any relationship between health effects on the claimants and their chemicals. Most of the class actions have been settled out of court. The US government continues to deny the effects of Agent Orange on the Vietnamese people and the persistent poisoning of land and water supplies. The fact that corporations played a central role in the Vietnamese ecocide is not peripheral or coincidental. It cannot be reduced to a footnote in history. As we shall discover in the book, corporations are playing the central role in the global ecocide that we face now. It is important to be clear about what is meant by the term corporation. It is used in this book to mean any profit-making organisation that is incorporated, as an entity that is separate from its shareholders or investors. This means any for-profit organisation that has the status of a separate person in law, something we will explore in some detail in Chapter 1 of this book, from the people that have a financial stake in it, either as owners or shareholders. Most of the world's key commodities are owned and controlled by corporations. It is estimated that since 1965, 20 corporations have collectively produced 35% of all fossil fuel emissions. Since 1988, just 100 have collectively produced 71% of all fossil fuel emissions. The biggest offenders are ExxonMobil, Shell, BP, and Chevron. Almost all of the plastic that is choking our oceans is produced by for-profit corporations. Greenpeace has listed the biggest offenders as Coca-Cola, PepsiCo, Nestle, Danone, Mondelez International, Procter & Gamble, Unilever, Perfetti Van Melle, Mars, and Colgate-Palmolive. It is estimated that 60% of Coca-Cola's packaging is single-use plastic. Most ambient air pollution, the air pollution caused by particles released into the environment when fuel is used or other things are burned, is produced by profit-making corporations. Ambient air pollution is a major killer, contributing to 4.2 million early deaths every year. The deadliest chemicals in our water and air, such as pesticides and dioxins, are produced almost entirely by profit-making corporations. Perhaps the most systematic study of the influence of corporations in the global economy has been conducted by researchers at the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology in Zurich. The researchers analysed the ownership patterns of over 37 million corporations and investors worldwide to map exactly who owns what. This mapping exercise revealed that 737 corporations control about 80% of the wealth, and 147 corporations control about 40%. In other words, most of the world's wealth is controlled by a relatively small network of elite corporations. And since this seminal study was conducted, the market concentration of corporate structures has increased significantly. This small network of elite corporations are the key agents in climate change and the eco-crisis. It is this small network that is killing us. Conspicuous by its absence. Yet, as the central role played by the corporate economy in this eco-crisis has been conspicuously absent from the public debate, the role that the corporation plays in this looming catastrophe is almost always ignored in the most significant scientific reports on climate change and global pollution. Pick up any of the reports by the UN or the international financial institutions, or indeed any of the global health organizations, and you will not see any discussion of the corporation's role in the growing environmental catastrophe. The Paris Agreement, for example, includes no acknowledgement of the key role that profit-making corporations play in climate change. It fails to mention the words corporation, company, profit, or indeed make any reference to the key roles played by corporate management or corporate investors in the text. Precisely the same can be said about all of the key manuals, reports, and agreements on this subject that are produced by international organizations. The detailed manuals supporting the Kyoto Protocol included no reference to those terms, with one exception. A solitary footnote asserts that an entity can be a company, plant, or broker authorized by a party to hold or trade in emissions. The Kyoto Protocol, therefore, only mentions corporations when it asserts their role as participants in the new system of emissions trading that was established by the treaty. Other key climate change reports mention corporations only in passing. When they are mentioned, It is only in the context of their positive contribution to policy or carbon reduction strategies, such as in the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change's seminal special report on global warming of 1.5 degrees. We can say the same thing about other key official documents on the eco-crisis, including the World Bank's Climate Change Action Plan, the World Health Organization's Reducing Global Health Risks Through the Mitigation of Short-Lived Climate Pollutants, and the International Agency for Research on Cancers, Air Pollution and Cancer. Any efforts to reduce climate change are bound to fail unless we confront the reality that the vast majority of the major threats to our environment are currently produced and controlled by profit-making corporations. Yet, in the international treaties and in many of the radical proposals to transform our economy, corporations are either envisaged as a solution to the crisis or are ignored completely. We can make a similar observation about the agenda that has emerged to promote a Green New Deal and a Green Industrial Revolution. Take, for example, the proposal presented by the US politician Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, setting out how the US government could create a Green New Deal. The proposal is extensive and radical, and it sets out a blueprint for the transformation of the economy. Yet it stops short of making any proposals for the reform of the corporate economy. Of course, the context is important here. This proposal was tabled in the second legislature of the world's leading capitalist nation, the US House of Representatives. Because of this, Ocasio-Cortez is understandably being strategic about her targets. In other versions of the Green New Deal, developed in places that do not need to be so politically cautious or strategic, we will still find a lack of discussion about the corporation as a problem that needs to be confronted head-on. In the international trade union movement, the adoption of Green New Deal proposals tend to be based on the idea that a just transition to a carbon-neutral economy can be achieved in partnership with corporations. Environmental historian Stefania Barsa has shown that the International Trade Union Confederation and the International Labour Organization promote a sustainable version of capitalism that can be achieved through dialogue and democratic consultation with social partners and stakeholders. Through this process, corporations are persuaded to come to their senses and change their ways. In short, the dominant approach that is currently present in trade union demands for a Green New Deal would mean the continuation of a model of capitalism which retains the profit-making corporation as its main protagonist. This approach will not be enough to protect workers and supply chains with global corporations at the head. There is powerful evidence that the intensification of labour in agricultural supply chains, combined with rising global temperatures, has already given rise to deadly new occupational diseases. This book will argue that a viable Green New Deal will have to contend with the problem of corporate power head-on. New forms of organisation must replace, rather than sit alongside, profit-making, share-owned corporations. Because, as this book will show, the latter are incapable of contributing to a sustainable economy. After attending the UN General Assembly in September 2019, the anti-apartheid leader, Archbishop Desmond Tutu, clearly disappointed by the lack of any discussion of the role of the
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.